Welcome to the Graduation Equity Webinar Series. I'm Kathy Anderson, System Improvement Program Supervisor Lead. And today we are talking about the balanced calendar and scheduling. This meeting is being recorded and it should be available probably this afternoon on YouTube. Closed captions are available, so you can get them in the menu if you want to do that. We're posting the PowerPoint in the chat. So if you want to follow along, we'll be dropping it in there for you as well. This webinar is brought to you through the Office of Student Engagement and Supports within the Office of the Superintendent of Public Instruction. At OSPI, we believe each student needs to be prepared for post-secondary pathways, careers, and civic engagement. The Graduation Equity Webinar Series was created with the purpose of highlighting practices that increase access to education and ultimately to graduation. Through our webinar, we're striving to examine and dismantle current policies and practices that result in disparate outcomes for our students. We have the ultimate goal of ensuring that each student has access to instruction and support that will make them successful in school and in life. I want to acknowledge this beautiful place where we live. February always feels like the dawning of spring to me. We come out of our winter layers and start to look forward to just the warmer days. You start to see shoots coming up in your garden and the promise of new life out there. So we ask that the participants of this meeting honor the traditional lands on which each of you are located today. And if you need help with this, our resource sheet has links that you can use. In my life, I mostly travel around the intersection of the traditional lands of the Squaxin Islands, the Coast Salish, the Cowlitz, and Nisqually tribes. And I'd like to acknowledge the Indigenous people who have stewarded this land since time immemorial and who still inhabit the area today. Welcome. Tribal consultation is a really great way to get to know your local tribes and begin relationships that benefit students and their families. And if you'd like to know more about it, we'd love to connect you with our Office of Native Education. And just looking at the chat, I see Puyallup, I see Tulalip, Yakima, awesome, Chehalis, Lummi, Skalam. Let's see. Well, Puyallup, lots of folks in here, Wanapum, Snoqualmie, Tulalip, welcome. We are glad to see y'all. Welcome. Let's go into this. So today we're talking about the balanced calendar and scheduling because schedules have the power to support students and educators. Great teachers need rest. And I know from myself as a first year teacher, I didn't have a classroom. I had a cart. I was one of those lucky teachers. I had three preps and I moved rooms every passing period. And everyone in my department had a different lunch. So if I needed help, I couldn't ask their advice midday. And there was just never enough time to really help the kids that needed it the most. I know some of my kids were hunters, and I remember several students being gone for a few weeks and never being able to get caught back up. And I'd spend every Sunday grading papers and lesson planning, and my breaks trying to get caught up. And it really felt like they wanted me to fail. And we don't want that for any of our teachers. They should feel like it's possible and that it's a sustainable way to live. A great school schedule takes into account the culture of the students. It plans purposefully to proactively provide those supports. It provides time for teachers to be prepared and intentionally decreases the stress of transitions for everyone. Having a thoughtful schedule also has the power to propel students to their desired futures. We can set productive defaults by eliminating classes that won't earn a student credit and expanding courses that can earn them credits in higher education or that apply to their life goals. And while there are high quality summer learning options, we know they aren't available to all students. Ultimately, we want school to be a place where people are energized and engaged, and the schedule has a lot of power to decide who gets support and who gets left behind. So today we'll be talking about what a balanced calendar is and steps to integrating it into your school schedule. You'll hear from folks who've done it and learn about their intercession offerings. And we'll talk about some lessons learned and some implications for the high school and beyond plan, like credit flexibility and ways to incorporate student voice and choice. For this first half, I'm joined today by my colleague, Kim Reichdahl. She's our Director of Graduation and Pathway Preparation at OSPI. Kim leads school counseling and can help you with the ASCA model, high school and beyond planning, and so much more. And we also have with us David Hornak, the Executive Director for the National Association for Year-Round Education. And I'll tell you a little bit more about him in a little bit. We like to get to know our audience. So I'm going to launch a poll and we can learn a little bit more about all of you. So we'd love to know about your position, what grade bands, and how familiar you are with our topic today. I know I had never heard of balanced calendar before I saw it at AWSB last year, so it's new. We're getting some results. I'm seeing lots of school counselors, a lot of middle, high school, or both folks in the room. It looks like people are somewhat familiar with the topic. Very cool. And let's watch it. And we also have quite a few administrators, district office folks going on. And there's a lot of people that this is new to, but the majority say they are somewhat familiar. So thank you for participating in the poll. And if you didn't get a chance, no big deal, guys. And people are putting in the chat other possibilities. We see gear up, school psychologists, sec assistants. Very cool. Benefit secretary. Education Association president. Very cool. Welcome. So we are going to go to Kim to talk a little bit about the connection between scheduling and the high school and beyond plan. So Kim, welcome. Good to see you.
Thank you, Kefi, and thank you everyone for making time to be here today. Again, my name is Kim Reichdahl, and I'm serving OSPI currently as the Director of the Graduation Pathway Preparation Team. So that does include school counseling, dual credit, CT equivalencies, career connected learning, lots of ways that we're working to increase flexibility for students in meeting their graduation requirements. But I also come to you in this space with a long time, 20 year history as a school counselor and before that as a teacher. And what I remember most when I transitioned to OSPI was that initial feeling of loss of my summer break and my winter break. And I'm being honest about that because what I also remember equally clearly is how much I had to hold on by my fingernails at times of the year in order to make it to that next break, because the work that we do is so intensive and so all-consuming that I really am excited to be in this space here with you, not only from my lived experience, but also from the lens of the work I've been able to support and lead at OSPI, which is also really big system change work. And when we think about student support systems, when we think about a high school and beyond plan as that framework of guidance for that secondary school experience for students, that obviously is predicated on what happens in our elementary schools, this all fits really well in my locus of influence in the work that we get to do. And I just want to share a little perspective around how we can use existing systems and existing structures to really think about building opportunities for our students through a balanced calendar approach. And obviously, I think it's clear anytime we are thinking about making a systemic change to a norm that we have existed in for a long time, it's really important to gather your data, your information, and especially your feedback from those for whom that systemic change is going to have the most impact. So in this case, our students and our staff are going to be the ones most potentially likely to feel the benefit and the change of a system shift like going to a balanced calendar. So I want to talk a little bit about how our biggest repository of student voice that we have when utilized well, that high school and beyond plan, can really bring out some of that data for you as a way to inform some of your thoughts around how are we going to develop courses and programs within this shifted calendar. What might our activities and extracurriculars look like if we're really thinking about serving our students differently? How might we provide remediation and enrichment opportunities through a more balanced calendar approach where we can build in those opportunities to our daily schedule as well as our year-long calendar and really look at how we're connecting to students' academic, career, and social emotional development through that post-secondary planning. Next, please. Or do I have it? Oh, I see it. Thanks, Kepi. I got control. All right. Thanks for that, Kepi. So I'm sure many of you are familiar with the graphic on the screen right now. It's our visual of Washington's multi-tiered system of support. Just that visual for me as a visual learner helps cue me to really think about how a system shift like this is going to need all the components of that tiered support system to make that shift happen for our staff, students, and families. And so a lot of this goes hand in hand with each other. If you've got a strong MTSS already in place, this may feel very familiar to you as just yet another way we're really looking at our data, connecting with our families, students, community members, using those evidence-based practices that you're going to hear about from our guest speakers today. And really, most importantly, from my lens anyway, is building that continuum of supports for our students that really helps develop their academic, career, and social emotional skills and move them towards that shift out of our system into that meaningful first step for them. One of the great joys of my life as a professional in the last year and a half is I've gotten to support the implementation of Senate Bill 5030, which Kathy mentioned earlier. It's the shift in our state to a comprehensive school counseling program that is based on national evidence-based practices from the ASCA national model. And it is inclusive of not only school counselors and sort of some definition around their role within that system, but also the inclusion of our social workers, school psychologists, our nurses, and all the many other staff who really work in tandem with each other as a team to support our students' academic, career, social, emotional, mental health, behavioral health, and physical needs. So when we think about how we are approaching the idea of a balanced calendar, we can also think about it in terms of how are we meeting those needs of every student at that tier one level? How are we providing additional opportunities for students who might need some tier two support services in any of those areas? And then what else can we build into our system to really address those students needing that wraparound approach of support from us as the staff and the communities in which we are serving those schools. So when we think about taking a look at data, this is where we've got this repository. And I just want to highlight a few ways in which student voice, as documented in their high school and beyond plan, when pulled out, can really inform the building of your opportunities for your students through a balanced calendar. So you're going to hear words like intercession today, opportunities to build in mini units and opportunities to build in time within shortened periods during a balanced calendar year, as well as words we probably are a little more familiar with, like advisory or homeroom, where we can build in that time within the school day to interact with students in those academic, career, and social emotional domains. So when we think about using our data to inform that, think about the kind of information we can pull out of a high school and beyond plan. So when I was the career and college counselor at Olympia High School, it was my colleague at my sister high school at Capital who was a former marketing teacher and really taught me the absolute intentionality of using data in the high school and beyond plan to serve students in ways that connected them better to what they were doing in that process and how it could inform course choices, how it could inform their activities and engagement both in and out of our school. Well, as staff, when we think about how we can use that information, those safe careers can help build our elective programs or our CTE programs. It can help inform us on what kind of guest speakers, career speakers might we want to bring into our school when we used to pull a list of the top 25 saved careers in the high school. And that was my list of careers to try to bring into my homeroom system every Friday for guest speakers. And then students would get that invitation to come join based on what was in their high school and beyond plan. Field trips, once we continue to move back towards that experience or site-based, work-based visits to see some of the opportunities in our communities. Again, what kind of activities and clubs are we offering? How do we build our career day to be inclusive as much as possible of the kinds of careers we're seeing our students show an interest in? How do we build work-based learning, job shadow, site visit experiences? All of these things can fit into intercession, can fit in through advisory and homeroom, or fit in different ways as you think about a more balanced calendar. Students post-high school plans, obviously, if we're seeing a significant number of students who are wanting to go into apprenticeships after high school, how do we build those CTE pre-apprenticeship or apprenticeship prep programs within our schools to feed into that interest, feed into our local industry in our area? Maybe it's dual credit courses. We've got a lot of students wanting to go into certain careers that necessitate a 2 or a 4 year college education. How do we build our grad pathways for our students and offer opportunities for students to maybe take the SAT or the ACT in our school during an intercession? Or maybe we do some test prep around those types of pathway preparation opportunities, offering the ASVAB, right? Many of our schools have gone to giving that as a 10th grade career interest inventory for students because it gives such great information. How can we build that into our calendar? So all of these are ways in which we can use post-high school plans to guide our decisions. The courses that students are planning to take as they build out their academic plan, oh my gosh, the implications for master schedule development, really tying our teachers to an understanding of what students are wanting and needing to prepare for their post-secondary goals, really looking at what kind of training might we need to get staff if we've got a student surge of interest in college in the high school, or maybe it's international baccalaureate or advanced placement or a particular CTE program that we might need to get some new curriculum for. All these ways to think about how we can support our staff in building those skills to meet student needs and interests. And then when we look at what they're saving into their resume or their activity log, similarly to that saved careers block that I showed you first, again, lots of opportunities to build connection and relationship with students, to have conversations with them as teachers and staff about job opportunities that fit with their interests or help them build that resume and practice getting that first job within the context of maybe it's a different calendar approach. I will say that obviously may necessitate some community support, and you're going to hear about that from some of our guest speakers today in ways to build that community support for adjusting what has been our norm for students to take those first steps towards a career. So lots of ways to use this information. I appreciate the time, Keffi, to share that with this group, and I am excited for the rest of our speakers today.
Awesome. Thanks, Kim. Next, we're going to go to Dr. David Hornak. He's Doctor of Education. He's lived and worked in Holt, Michigan for the past 29 years. As an employee of Holt Public Schools, he's taught young fives, kindergarten, first grade, and reading recovery. And Dr. Hornak was promoted 16 years ago, as he became the instructional leader or principal of Horizon Elementary. Horizon's a year-round school. It operates on a balanced calendar. Dr. Hornak has presented over 150 times to school boards, district officials, community groups, and parent-teacher organizations across the world. And just regarding this alternate calendar and wellness initiatives, such as the walking school bus. His dissertation was titled "The Impact of Summer Recess on Mathematical Learning Retention," and it was selected in 2016 as National Dissertation of the Year by the National Council of Professors of Educational Administration. It further supports the need for school officials interested in minimizing summer learning loss to consider the balanced calendar. In 2015, Dr. Hornak was named Executive Director of the National Association for Year-Round Education and was promoted as superintendent of schools in Holt. Dr. Hornak and his partner, Anne, are proud parents of daughter, Olivia, and son, Maxwell. Welcome, Dr. Hornak. Great to see you.
Thank you. I'm tickled to be here with you today. You know, working over the last couple of years with stakeholders from Washington, I deeply appreciate the work that's going on, as well as the people I've had the opportunity to work with. I say this in a very school appropriate way, but I'm falling in love with everyone I work with. And so I look forward to sharing my understanding of the balanced calendar, engaging in some dialogue potentially through the chat with you over the course of the next 30 minutes. So here you will find my contact information. That was a wonderful introduction. I'm going to bring a little bit more of that to life in a few slides from now. To that end, I am a superintendent in mid-Michigan. We have approximately 5,000 students, 850 employees, and something goes wrong every day. To that end, I'm addicted to serving my learning community and partnering with each of you. As noted, in 2015, I was appointed as the executive director for the National Association for Year-Round Education. So I hope you'd consider following us on any of these sites and connecting with me at any point. My best email is my work email, dhornak, H-O-R-N-A-K, at hpsk12.net. We have a video here, and this video helps us set the stage for our future discussions.
They're from one of the millions of low-income American families. Let's look at two children, one from a middle-income family, the other from one of the millions of low-income American families. As the two kids head off to kindergarten, look what happens. The middle-income child starts out with a six-month lead. The low-income child is already falling behind because of a lack of access to early reading and preschool education. During their year in kindergarten, in the same school and classroom, the two children will learn at about the same rate, so we'll move them both forward 9 months. But look what happens in that first summer between kindergarten and first grade. Our middle-income child moves ahead about a month in reading because learning of one kind or another continues over the summer. The low-income child falls back about 2 months. So when school begins again, when they go back for first grade, the gap between them has already widened. During first grade, again, they move ahead at about the same rate, another 9 months. That next summer, the activities and lifestyle of the middle-income family keep that child moving forward, but the low-income child has fewer opportunities to reinforce good habits like reading, and that child falls farther behind. Then we come to second grade, and again, our two children learn at the same rate. But the summer after second grade sets our low-income child back again, and our middle-income child moves forward again, and the gap widens again. By just the third grade, the two children are already far apart. By the end of fifth grade, the gap between the children is 2.5 to 3 years. It will keep growing through middle school. So you see, without addressing what's happening during the summer, it is impossible to ever catch up. It's impossible to close the gap. No matter how much high-quality learning goes on from September to June, every year the gap widens.
Again, that video will be used as a reference as we continue to navigate this slide deck. There are many benefits to the balanced calendar. And the primary benefits, which may be the driver for why we're here today together, happen to be, how do we have a positive impact on all stakeholders? So I'm going to start with what is known as the summer slide. So these are not in any particular order, but let me tell you that during the summer, all students regress academically. And the balanced calendar, by its premise of removing a couple of your typical weeks off during the summer and inserting them into the calendar and other parts of your academic year. In theory, students retain more information. Therefore, we push back or focus on minimizing the summer slide. I can tell you as we emerge from a pandemic that in my district and districts around the nation, we are trying to find methods to address unfinished learning that may have occurred. We did our best. Educators, you deserve credit. You pivoted overnight, going from our traditional face-to-face delivery to, in many cases, an online platform. And in my particular school district, we were virtual for 1 year to the day. The reality is, that created some unfinished learning. And instead of using a deficit term like a learning gap, and you'll hear me say that periodically, we're really starting to focus on how do we address the unfinished learning that may have occurred during the pandemic. Now, if we step back and think about, most Washington districts have a 10 or 11 week summer. The balanced calendar is best positioned with a 6 to 8 week summer. So if you're going to move in the direction of a balanced calendar, I could see that occurring over time. For instance, you may consider adding 1 week to your academic year and reducing summer by a week. 1 year, the next year adding another, and then finally adding a third break throughout the school year. And by doing so, the calendar aligns better with current lifestyles. We find that we have access to our students on a more regular basis. So while we talk a pretty good game in education, and we often say we're going to provide food in the summer, we're going to provide academic access to materials, we are going to provide care and shelter and clothing or anything else that a school district is now being asked to do, it's very difficult to do so when we don't have regular access to the students. The balanced calendar affords us more regular access to our students. But there are benefits to the adults as well. When you can work really hard for approximately 6 weeks and take a 1 to 2 week break, teacher morale is improved. That also has a positive benefit on the nationwide teacher burnout. Approximately 50% of educators leave the profession in their first 5 years. We can't afford that. We have a nationwide teacher shortage. We need to retain all of the amazing people that we have in our systems. It's been noted that balanced calendar educators are in attendance more frequently. They tend to take their annual dentist appointments and doctor's appointments during a scheduled school break rather than during the school year. Thus, a positive impact on the nationwide substitute teacher shortage. There's another reason our balanced calendar schools are healthier. Balanced calendar schools have more opportunity to be deep cleaned more frequently. So you can see there are benefits to the students, and that student voice, students should be our driver. But I can tell you with confidence that the benefits include the adult stakeholders who are serving our kids each and every day. So in the state of Washington, you are required, unless you have some type of waiver, to serve your kids 180 days and you have a number of hours your students need to be in school. But you know, the reality is you are serving some students that only need 150 days of instruction, but you make them go 180. The bulk of the students we all serve function quite well on the 180 school day calendar. But as we emerge from a pandemic, we have students in our system that need 220 or more days of school to complete that unfinished learning, and we only give them 180. How in the world is that fair? By instituting something called intercession, in association with the balanced school calendar, select kids can return to school during a scheduled break for 220 to 230 school days in what we call intercession. More on that soon. So the reality is everyone in Michigan, everyone in Washington are being asked to remediate the learning gaps that the traditional calendar creates if you are operating on a traditional calendar. In other words, your school calendar is contributing to those learning gaps. American children spend the least amount of time in the classroom as compared to other countries. And as noted, currently the school year length on average in the United States is 180 days. We at the National Association for Year-Round Education are urging our stakeholders across the nation, educational leaders, to pursue a balanced calendar. Not to add necessarily school days to your calendar, but adopt a balanced calendar, adopt intercession, and before you know it, select students could attend school between 215 to 225 days. Some are going to be returning for pre-teaching opportunities. Pre means before the actual lesson. That would have been really good for me. Some are coming to intercession to be retaught, while others are joining intercession to be enriched. So in short, what is a balanced calendar? A balanced calendar modifies the typical 180-day school calendar to keep the learning process more continuous. Students have periodic shorter breaks rather than one long intermission. The most researched model includes 9 weeks of instruction with 3 weeks off. But the calendar that my district functions on doesn't marry well with the most researched model. We actually engage our stakeholders and ask them to dream about the ideal calendar for them. We look back at 5 years of attendance from our students and our faculty, and we strategically place our breaks accordingly. Balanced calendar districts have several short vacations throughout the year rather than 1 3-month summer break. So here is the why. Why in the world would we consider this? The amount of knowledge that is lost during a summer break is paramount. It continues to become more dramatic as students get older, as illustrated by the video. John Hattie and his team study studies. They study and they conduct a meta-analysis on a variety of topics. Hattie and team have indicated that summer has a negative impact on all kids. 2/3 of the achievement gap in 9th grade can be attributed to the amount of required time it takes a teacher to reteach and review. Traditional calendar educators, you are reteaching between 20 and 40 days each year. That equation doesn't work if we're supposed to be demonstrating that each child has command of that year's curriculum in 180 days, and you unplug up to 40 of those days. I'm just not sure how we have the time to navigate the curriculum as it's been laid out. All children lose, on average, 2.6 months of math skills during the summer break annually. And I can't say this enough. We are being asked to remediate the learning gaps that the traditional calendar creates. School districts across the nation are spending millions of at-risk and title funds to help close the learning gaps that we are contributing to. Across the nation, we are spending $21 billion, 21 with a B, billion, remediating the learning gaps that we are contributing to. I would love one of those Bs and repurpose those into opportunities for kids. Balanced calendar strengths. Continuity of instruction equals quality. Our educators are better able to plan and prepare. They can look back at where they've been and look forward to where they're going. They can catch a breath. intercession for remediation and balance calendar enrichment. There's a reduction in the summer slide. Teacher attitudes are better. There is less teacher burnout due to the frequent breaks. And there is, of course, that positive impact to the nationwide substitute shortage. You can see the difference in the calendars here. You have the traditional calendar near the top of the screen. And there in the middle, you see the balance calendar. And you can see large chunks on the traditional calendar, and you can see balanced chunks of learning in days off on the balance calendar. So upper left of the screen, that's me as a student in mid-Michigan, and I was required to go to summer school. And I often wonder, would have that been the case if I were on the balance calendar? Second picture on the left, that's me as a first year kindergarten and young fives teacher. I predict you haven't seen someone with larger ears than myself, and it took me a few years to figure this out, but I started telling my students that I could hear everything, and it served as a wonderful class management tool, and my students were nice and quiet. I reference the fact that I was a high school soccer coach, because one of the things that I continue to hear is this can't be done due to fall sports, and it is being done across the nation. The bottom left picture is me as a first year principal. And before I tell you a little bit more about that, I would love to play a quick video for you, I think. Let's see. Here we go. I may need an assist. Okay. A little bit of slow motion on my end. Maybe you saw it in real time, but that is my daughter, Olivia. That is my daughter, Olivia, at her college orientation. And that's exactly how I felt teaching on the traditional calendar. Every single year, I would start the year cheering, so excited with opportunity. And in October, every single year, I'd fall flat on my face, exhausted, and limp to the finish line in June. Lower left, me as a principal, on the balance calendar, wondering why in the world do I have endless energy? Why do all of my educators in my building have endless energy? I needed to return to graduate school to learn as much as I possibly could on the balance calendar, and did so. As noted earlier, in 2015, I successfully defended my dissertation. I was appointed the executive director of the National Association for Year-Round Education, and I became the superintendent of schools in a district that I've been in my entire life, outside of my own K-12 experience. Towards the right of the screen, you will see my partner, Ann, my son, Maxwell, my daughter, Olivia, and 5 days a week, you can find me in a bow tie. So if you're ever making your way to mid-Michigan and you see a 6'4", big-eared, bow tie wearing person, come up and say hi, please. Now, here's the story of Olivia. Both of my children attended the balance calendar for elementary. At the time, we had a weak infrastructure and not all of our schools had air conditioning. So our kids would transition off the balance calendar to a traditional calendar. The first year, her summer went from a 6-week summer to an 8-week summer because she was transitioning calendars. The next year, it went to a 12-week summer. And it was in the fall parent-teacher conferences when her teacher slid some data across the table saying, she's such a nice girl, and she's only a year behind in reading. Mind you, my wife's a college professor, at the time I was an elementary principal, we can provide any resource you can imagine for our kids. And she was impacted by the summer slide. All kids are impacted by the traditional calendar. What Balanced Calendar employees say is also backed by research. We also walked through some of this already, but teachers in year-round programs appreciate the continuity of instruction, and they believe that the quality is better. They love this calendar because they can be reflective practitioners. They can look back at where they've been, and they can look forward to where they're going, and it's not such a sprint. It's more of a marathon. They're better able to plan on regular intervals. It's more efficient and productive to plan curriculum for shorter blocks, and they believe that the time segments provide ample opportunities to navigate that. There's an enhanced level of professionalism. The majority of teachers on year-round schools favor the year-round calendar. I've yet to meet a year-round educator who is elected to go back to a traditional calendar, as there's improved morale, motivation, and it has a positive impact on burnout and stress. And again, our teachers are in the classroom more frequently due to this particular calendar. The benefits of the calendar continue. Intercession programs allow opportunities to enhance and supplement the regular curriculum. Intercession allows teachers to experiment. So in Michigan, we have turned to core programs, and we have lost track of the art of teaching and intervening with something we know will help a child in favor of those core programs. Intercession allows us to experiment with remediation and enrichment and restore the art of education. Another advantage is there's less review time that's necessary at the beginning of each instructional block. And researchers claim that the balanced calendar has benefits for our low SES students in particular, but the newest research is indicating that the balanced calendar has benefits for all students. This is called the faucet theory, and the faucet theory is the underpinning of this particular topic. I want you to just go ahead and rename one low income and the other middle and upper class. And the reality is, when our students are in the classroom in front of you, the resources are flowing as the water would flow at the same rate. But in the summer, the low income faucet is turned off, as illustrated by the video, when our middle and upper class students continue to be enriched in some capacities. Again, they still suffer from the summer slide or the summer setback or brain drain, whatever you want to call it, but not at the same rate as our low SES kids. This particular model has a positive impact on behaviors and health. Focused and engaged children tend to behave better. And I will tell you that I truly believe when our adults can look back at where they've been and look forward to where they're going, catch a breath and come back energized, they're going to engage the students at a deeper level. Now, we do a brief behavior expectation following each break. And that time following each break allows for more instructional time on current curriculum. And balanced calendar schools tend to have better attendance as they are often deep cleaned more frequently, keeping students and staff more healthy. So here's a crosswalk, and I will cruise through this because my time is nearing the end. To that end, balanced calendar in this particular case started August 3rd. Traditional calendar started August 18th. I would like to take you down to fall break. Fall break on the balanced calendar is a 2-week October break, when the traditional calendar only has a 1-week October break. The balanced calendar has a full week off at Thanksgiving, and the traditional calendar only has a Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday off at Thanksgiving. winter break is consistent. Midwinter break is a Friday and a full week off. For the balance calendar, traditional calendar is just a full week off. Spring break is a 2 week spring break on the balance calendar and a 1 week break for the traditional calendar. And then there is a 1 week memorial break. The balance calendar ends late June, while the traditional calendar ends early to mid-June. Now, what's critical to point out here is that in some cases, districts have two calendars, and you may have siblings on two different calendars. So we point out the commonalities so families can make plans accordingly. So it's important for you to determine the needs of your environment. Work with your community to ensure no students will be left without intersession opportunities, childcare, or summer activities. Work with your educational partners to ensure that all children can access outside programming when you're on a school break. And I urge you to hold lots of professional development and community meetings. And I'm here for you. If you would like me to Zoom in, I'm happy to do so. I'm often asked the following questions. Does the balanced calendar have a positive impact on the children that score within the bottom 30% on standardized tests? Yes, the faucet theory speaks to that, but the newest research indicates that the balanced calendar benefits all students. How would our families manage two calendars if we only had our elementary students attend the balanced calendar? This happened to the Hornaks, and it allowed me to individualize my parenting time. So for the first time in my career, I wasn't serving other children. I was able to serve my own. And that was amazing. Does the entire district need to transition at once? No. However, districts are most efficient when operating on one calendar. There are no additional costs if you're on one calendar. There are some additional costs if you're doing a multi-track or a school within a school model. And if you're considering either one of those, please reach back out. I can share more. I'm often asked, with strong partnerships with the educational service districts, how would we honor individualized education plans, also known as IEPs? Offer makeup sessions in September and May, so double up on therapy. Pay an ESD employee to offer children the therapies that they deserve and written into the IEP. Offer comp time for those working in August and June from the ESD or Educational Service District. Allow families to seek their own services to be paid by the district. We have done all three of those. And in the end, they meet the needs of the students we serve. The next question is, does the balanced calendar require specific adjustments to employee contracts? No. The entire Holt district has one contract. However, at times we have multiple guiding calendars due to employee groups. If our district were to adopt a balanced calendar, what kind of enrollment numbers do you forecast? We've seen this across the nation. Waiting lists at many grade levels, increase in overall numbers, as this is a better fit with current lifestyles and workloads. Here are some common concerns. Now, when I was growing up, we would have breakfast, we'd go out and play outside until the streetlights came on, and that was the time to go home. I've been told the balanced calendar requires more school days. That's not the case. We are here asking you to consider just using your 180 days differently. And please, please, please understand, we're not asking you to eliminate summer. Summer is still 6 to 8 weeks if you are doing this as a bona fide year-round program or a balanced calendar program. I've been told that you can't run this because of high school athletics. That's just not the case. It's happening around the United States. As a former high school soccer coach, I would run my fitness practice at 6 in the morning before the heat of the day, and I would run my tactical practice at 4 p.m, again, avoiding the heat of the day. Students could go to school. Summer employment for staff. You will hear some staff members say, well, you're taking the opportunity away from me for my ability to supplement my income. The rebuttal to that is, why don't you work one intersession to supplement your income and then enjoy the rest of the school breaks? Summer employment for students. I get it. Michigan has the Great Lakes. Many of our kids are working in ice cream shops and supporting the local economy. Again, summer is done right between 6 and 8 weeks. So we're not eliminating summer, which is, again, one of the common concerns. The annual cleaning schedule. Yep, our custodians love them so much. We will move their cheese. We deep clean in the summer, but there's no reason we can't deep clean during a scheduled break. I've been told this model costs more. It gets in the way of family traditions and that traditional schools are more equitable. I would like to just go on record. I don't know of a more inequitable thing in education at the moment. Basically, we're planning for learning loss to occur by hiring interventionists and special ed teachers and you name it, all the additional supports like paraeducators. We are basically saying good luck to our students in the summer. And at the end of the day, I'm desperately seeking more opportunities to serve my kids. Blended calendars are more challenging. Balanced calendars are more challenging for blended families. I'm going to take you back to that one where I talked about individualized parenting time. Our families who are divorced or living apart have actually gone on record to say that more frequent breaks allow them more opportunities to see their children in a shared custody arrangement. And balanced calendars only benefit struggling students. That's just not the case. All kids benefit from the balanced calendar. Now, I talked about when I was a kid, and I believe that many of us hope and dream to have that same experience for our own children. But our kids are actually connecting virtually through gaming systems and cell phones. They're not going outside and playing like they once did. Well, where are we going from here? Call on a local expert or connect with the National Association for Year-Round Education. Communicate often. Hold informational sessions. Link with your local educational partners. Connect with local and state level lawmakers. Make sure they know what's going on. And work to inform your community. We're going to break now for a poll.
Thank you, David. And while we're doing this polling, I think we can take some questions from our audience too. So Jocelyn, you had a couple questions kind of pending there. Do you want to share?
Yes. So there are a few. I do not imagine we'll get to all of them, but we can get to them with our Q&A with our panelists. One of the big questions is, how does this intercession impact district budgets? If students can attend during this time, is it going to be additional time or days for teachers? Paras, transportation, building administrators, et cetera, this would add 3 weeks of additional pay for almost all employees.
That's a wonderful question. Very, very thoughtfully crafted and written and submitted. So thank you for that. Schools across the nation that are operating intercession invite targeted kids back for remediation or enrichment. So only a portion of the kids return. Only a portion of the staff is needed. The staff is paid. The buses do run. And we are feeding kids. Many districts use grant funds to fund intercession. And to that end, there are some districts that charge a tuition below the childcare rate for the community. And that is the, you know, maybe not the preferred way of doing it, but it is done that way across the nation and should just be, you know, known that tuition is an option, but primarily through grant funding. And I get it. Adding school days for all kids will be extremely expensive, but we have found that only a portion of the kids return for remediation and or enrichment.
Thanks, Dr. Hornak. Another question we had is, what are the benefits or impacts on SPED with this model? And has this been studied?
Yeah, so our special education kids thrive on this particular model. If they're not on an extended school year, the re-entry in August or September can be very dramatic and elongated. Now, I will just put it out there that the balanced calendar elementary school that I referenced early in the session, we also housed an autistically impaired basic classroom, which meant that our most severely impaired kids were being sent to my building. So while there's several research gaps due in part to the fact that the pandemic the pandemic caused some discomfort in collecting reliable data, I can tell you anecdotally, our kids, our most severely impaired students, thrived on the balanced calendar. They did have a short reentry period following each break, but it certainly outweighed the multiple week and month reentry period that occurs often after a long summer intermission. And by nature, when our kids have shorter breaks, a shorter summer, more frequent breaks, they're not losing as much of the knowledge that they once did, which has a positive impact on their academics. So yes, this model benefits all kids, but it really can have a positive on our special education students.
One more question was, Don asked, what is meant by deep clean and what is entailed in this?
So in our case, the traditional model is when the kids go away and the adults go away, we have our schools deep cleaned by our custodians. And what we do in our particular district is the custodians from across the district show up in one building and a week later, they have it all cleaned and they go to another one. And so we call it gang cleaning or group cleaning. I understand that some of you are a one building district or a one campus district, and you may not have a surplus of people. But by deep cleaning more frequently, the germs go away and you're able to keep your building healthier.
Awesome. And I see there are some more questions in the Q&A, but I think we're going to talk about them with the panel. So that is up next. And it looks like there is some interest out there. So I just want to encourage people to reach out to David as you have questions, and you'll hear from our panelists what their experience has been like in Washington. And I just wanted to mention, OSPI does have a grant program that's been going the last couple of years to explore the balanced calendar and also to try it out. So I believe that's going to probably continue into this next year as well. So if people are interested, just know that that's there. And thank you so much, David. We were very pleased to have you today. And can we all give David a round of applause? I feel like I just appreciate him sharing his ideas and taking the time out this morning. So glad to have him with us. And all the kudos for this amazing work and just sharing these ideas, because I think you know, when you're born into a certain schedule or tradition, sometimes you don't get out of the box until people start asking questions about how might it be better and how can we innovate in this way. So I love the idea of looking at your community and seeing the days that they want off and that makes sense for the kids in the school and for the staff too. I think we all need that. So kudos to you. Thank you, Dr. Hornak. Questions already. So we are going to talk about what this looks like in Washington. And with us today, we have Lisa Gredvig. She is the superintendent of Union Gap School District. And Union Gap is majority elementary. They do not have a high school. So for the high school perspective, we have Mindy Schultz. She's the director of student success at Highland School District. Pardon me. So we are going to go to them. And both of these ladies have been trying out the strategy some newer than others, and that's totally great because the first year we know is a learning year. So I'm going to go to each one of you, and if you can just say a little bit about where you're at in the process. Let's go to Mindy first.
So I'm Mindy Schultz. Like we mentioned, I'm the Director of Student Success. My role is to manage the intercessions for the Highland School District. We are currently on year two of having what we call the Highland School District Instructional Calendar, which are steps towards a more balanced calendar. So we have three intercessions that we have throughout the school year, and we've extended our school year farther into June and just a little bit in August.
Let's go to Lisa.
We studied balanced calendar all of last year. This year's our first year of implementation. We have an intercession in October, one in February, actually in 2 weeks, and one attached to April. And we also have our 2 weeks in summer.
So I know for me, when I was a teacher, summer was such a sacred time. And I know with year-round school, people are always like, but I love the summer, you know, and why would I ever get rid of that? What was your initial response for your staff, or were there things that you did proactively to get them on board?
Well, when we first started this conversation with our staff, it started out with what our students need. So it started really from the ground up from them, knowing what students needed. They needed more time. They determined that for various reasons. So then we started talking about what kind of time do you want to look at? And we looked at the 4-day work week. We looked at with doing enrichment and intervention on Fridays. We looked at a real like school year or school like wide, like taking it and really taking over July. We looked at extending our school day, and we came up with the idea of intercessions really from the teachers. So it wasn't as scary to the teachers because they had an active part in it. Our superintendent, when we came up with that, said no, absolutely no work in July. He kept that as sacred to our community and communicated that out. And our union did a survey with our teachers and asked them which was more important, starting later in August or getting out earlier in June. So they had a say in what it looked like, which really gave them some power and took away some of the scary idea of a balanced calendar.
I can echo pretty much all of that. That was the big thing. I think just getting people to understand what the definition of a balanced calendar is versus using the term year-round calendar scares everyone. I agree. July should be sacred, but at the same time, our staff was all gung-ho. They just wanted at least 8 weeks of summer. That was kind of their biggest issue, which was really easy to do. And a lot of people, if you really look at what summer looks like, it was really only for us, it was starting a week earlier and only going 2 weeks longer to add intercession. So it really isn't as scary once you look at it. I think it was really important for staff to actually look at an example calendar before, because people just assume what balanced calendar looks like. And until you actually give them examples, it was pretty scary until they understood that.
Yeah, I know the misconception out there is that you're adding more days of school. And what does that look like, especially for like funding and those kinds of things? So I am curious, like, did you have specific funding strategies? How, and like, what did that look like to fund the intersection?
Go ahead, Lisa. One of the big things that we did was we applied for the grant. So we did the study last year and used that the grant funds for that. This year, we're also using grant funds to fund that. But looking forward, what we can use, because we do so much enrichment as well as intervention, being able to use Title I funds, LAP funds, those kind of, I mean, you're looking at Title I funds and highly capable, is it also more funds that you can actually utilize? And we've always had to have done intervention after school. And we're finding this year, we don't need that. So really looking at the budget, which obviously I have to deal with, it is one of those things that you can find the funds to do it because you're offsetting the need for intervention, especially after school, for those people that do that.
And we started this process before we knew the grant existed. So when we first started looking at adding intersessions, we had already started pulling some of our program funding. And then when the grant came out, we chose to use the grant to do bigger purchased items. So buying a STEM volleyball curriculum or buying a phonics curriculum that can be used during intersession. So we've tried to use the balance calendar grant for sustainable items. So then we have those materials when we implement in the future. And our community groups have been a great help. So reaching out and hearing that we can have like our Mighty Tieton that's near, right in our Tieton Square, having them participate, that's been able to offset, like they'll teach a class and they'll bring in some of their materials and supplies.
Yeah, and Mindy, so thinking about like just participation generally, like have you had trouble staffing this, and are the students showing up? How do you make it not feel punitive?
And that's what our first thing was when we put this in place. We're like, here's our calendar, we have our weeks, is it even going to be staffed? And so we started there, and I did an interest survey with our staff, and I was able to figure out where our holes were going to be in which intersession. I was able to see where we were going to have more teachers in one area. We also opened it up that if just because you're a kindergarten teacher doesn't mean you need to teach kindergarten. So we had teachers, we had our high school science teacher come down and teach kindergarten science. So we've kind of opened it up to have people go other places and give them, that's also part of the break. And they felt energized working with different kids. So we realized we were actually the first intersession we had a bus driver shortage. So it was how to staff that. And we ended up being okay with some of our sub drivers, but it gave me an idea of staffing. And then we sent it out to students, and we did it the first time in conjunction with conference week. So we had conference week, and then 2 weeks later had our first intersession. So we have about a 98% attendance at our conferences. So we were able to one-to-one talk to every parent who was invited, explain it, and also explain it to our students who weren't behind, that this is why they're being invited to intersession, was actually enrichment, not because they were catching up. So having parents understand it is for everyone really helped with that aspect. And we ended up having about 50% attendance in our K-5. In our upper grades, we were about 30% in our very first intersession.
So just for my own clarification, I'm wondering, like, if I'm behind in like algebra or something like that, am I spending all day in algebra class, or do I get to go to art in the afternoon, or what does that look like?
That's a good question. So our high school is set up different than our K-8, and we set it up that it's college-like. So the kids get course offerings and they sign up for two courses. We have a first period and a second period. And if I'm coming for algebra support, I may select my math academic completion class. And then I get to pick an elective class. We want kids to have another option, just intervention. So we've offered, we also understand if you're in an intervention class, you're probably in an intervention class because of something. So we've been able to work with our staff and find like an anxiety course. So it's a course where kids learn about their brain and how to manage their anxiety. Or we've given them a PE class because maybe they need to do an enrichment or an intervention and then go out and do a PE. And when we talk PE at intercession, we try to think outside the box. So we've done like life sports where they learn cornhole, they learn frisbee golf. We've also done yoga. So trying to get them an alternative to what their traditional PE class looks like to expose them to something. We've been able to have our new high school counselor. She did FAFSA completion. We've done with one of our teachers, she's really great about doing applications and they did job interviews. So she tied that in. So we're trying to give them academic completion because we want them to complete the credit that they're in. And then we have intervention that's also Pocket that's working on like making up credit along with other ways. So we have two different ones for the high school. And we really have their advisor, which is part of, they work on their graduation plan. They work with them. Being the advisor is the one that says, hey, you can make up these three assignments during intercession. Now you can be passing. So we want the kids to understand specifically what they need to do so it feels manageable. We caught that from the very first intercession. Kids were walking in going, I don't know what I'm supposed to do to catch up. So we really worked with the advisors to show the kids, like, these are the three things you're going to complete, or here's the test you're going to retake and study for. So it gives them the steps they need to be able to get passing their class.
That's awesome. And Lisa, does that look, what does it look like in the elementary school? Are they?
Well, we're K-8. So K-5 is one session. And it's usually classes that are considered project-based learning that have set up, the teachers have set up. So it's fun students. Yeah. So regardless of whether the student was invited or the parent signed them up, we have it and we have an open enrollment. So it's open to all. The biggest requirement for staff is that it has to be K-5. It has to be, the class has to be inclusive to anyone, even on an IEP. So that works out really, really well. We have our 6 through 8. I mean, it's everything from kind of the same of what Mindy talked about, is that students have the opportunity to get caught up because we do have high school courses in our district. So they might be behind in Washington State history or their algebra class and want to get caught up. But we also have those extension classes like a CPR class. We are doing sports week. There's some interesting ones, cooking with fractions. So it really depends on the grade level on what it is, but the majority, that was a big thing for our families, is that it wasn't just for students that needed intervention. Intercession for us is eligible, you're eligible for the entire week. So it's not just students that are behind, but definitely teachers are inviting those students. And I saw a whole bunch of questions related to that. And I'm sure Mindy can say the same, what she talked about as it relates to conferences. That was huge in the fall for us, because I was just hoping the very first intercession we had in October that we'd have 20% of our student body, and we ended up with 41%. And so it's one of those things of talking to, when you're talking to the parents about what they need and what those opportunities are for them, you know, to get additional help, that it's huge. I was worried about this intercession because our conferences aren't until March for spring, that we were going to have lower, but it's at 39% right now. So it's almost exactly the same as it was. And would they still have the rest of the week to register students? The issue for us was parents didn't register their older kids, because for whatever reason, and because students were so excited about what happened in October, when I did all the student surveys, they wanted the opportunity to register themselves so that they didn't miss out, because a lot of classes were full. And so we're seeing a lot more secondary students, middle school students sign up this one for that reason, because they had that opportunity to sign up themselves. Of course, we contacted parents to make sure that was okay. So that was a biggie. So
it sounds like there's like a pre-registration process, so you know how many kids are going to show up ahead of time and how to staff it. And it's
the staffing question. I have too many staff for February. I had to tell some people that I couldn't accommodate them. And most of that is classified staff, not teaching staff. I had plenty. I have office staff, I have bus drivers, I have kitchen. We do feed our kids breakfast and lunch. So staffing, and I think that is all comes with the pre-work, like Mindy talked about, to make sure that you had buy-in. We did have a balanced calendar. I've been here 14 years, and we had a balanced calendar in this district prior, and it stopped because there was really no rhyme or reason for it. What was the why, basically? They stopped. And so this was a big thing for our community, because the majority of our families don't leave Union Gap. And so most of them were students in Union Gap that are now parents and are saying, yeah, I loved, intercession, yay, bring it back. So it was over 90% of our families wanted to have intercession. So.
Very cool. I mean, like, thinking about messaging on this, are there tips? Like, what are the things like that you learned through this? I mean, you've talked a little bit about conferences were a good pivot point just to talk to people about it and why it's cool. Were there other things that happened to kind of set it up for success that you might share? And Lisa, we can start with you too.
The big thing that we did during the study year, which was last year, is that I met with families, because one of the first things they hear on, as it relates to balanced calendar, some people use modified calendar, but we were just coming off of COVID, right? And so a lot of the families couldn't even wrap their head around what balanced calendar meant, like we talked about before. I mean, I had some families that thought that meant we were going online. It was crazy. And we also, I have 80% multi-language learners in my district. And so it was really important that translate correctly. What does balanced calendar actually mean? Yeah. And so really having that communication with families and for them to understand what it was before you went anywhere else was vital. But them understanding the why is huge. And that's how we started. And then we started with surveys. We started with meeting with all the families and then starting with the surveys, because we are a non-high district and our kids go to a large district in our area. It was one of the main questions that I didn't know what was going to happen was the families, did our calendar have to match that calendar for the, and it was a resounding no, they didn't care. So that really took a huge load off us, really looking at it. So, just getting parents to understand the why and who it was for and why, and then getting staff on board. Which obviously we started with staff before we started with community.
Nice. And I'm wondering about implementation too. Was there, by the numbers, did you guys see a difference happen for any specific group of students? And do you feel like it's been successful so far?
We found our elementary just naturally, parents were interested in having them come. It was much different for our K-5 than it was for our 6-12 or 7-12. As Lisa mentioned, between the junior high and the high school, it was much more advertising to the student and really getting their input of what do they want to see and how do we make this something they're interested in. So reaching out to our students, listening to our student groups. We've made advertising PowerPoints for the high school. So we do like a PowerPoint, a flyer, two advisory classes. We kind of have a system to advertise our courses. Each teacher makes a video talking about their course. So we play it for kids. We send it to parents. So it's kind of a, everyone helps. And really it's about selling it, where our elementary kind of sells itself. And we really just frame it in with parents. Like when you have conversations with parents and their kids are behind or their kids are not getting the enrichment they want their kids to get, then we bring up intercession. One of the interesting things is we had a community forum where we had our community come in and create goals for our district this year. And we were waiting for intercession to come up about changes they wanted to make or different things. And no one mentioned it. So finally at the end, we asked a pocket of parents, like, you haven't talked about intercession. And their response was, wait, you're keeping it, right? Like that was, they didn't even think of it as something to put in a conversation because they felt like it was already part of what was best for our kids and in our system after 1 year. So it showed our community understood the purpose and really found it as a benefit.
I haven't started calendar prep yet because I really want to see how our April intercession goes and if that's one of those things that needs to go away. Or stay, because it's going to be interesting. But anyway, so I think that what I'm finding already is that parents are calling me or leaving messages with my staff saying, do we have a calendar for next year yet? Are we still having intercession? I'm trying to make, vacation plans for October and want to make sure, and that was huge. I had one grandparent, literally granddad, just so excited when he did the survey during conferences last year, because he'd never been able to take his grandchildren fishing because they never had a break in fall. Mindy lives in the area in which I live, agricultural, and I know that was some questions throughout. And my husband happens to be one of the biggest employers in the Highland School District ag area. And I can tell you that kids are working for a week during intercession for my husband. So I know one of the questions came and that's an apple warehouse. So it does work. And so a lot of the questions have been, kids, and I spoke to North Mason School District community and some of their board members, a few weeks ago or so. And one of the student reps had, that was the big thing for them was student employment. And I don't think a lot of people realize when they think of a balanced calendar, how much is really lost. I mean, in our area, Cherry starts way before any school gets out, but employers take them as soon as they're done with school. And some of them just work on the weekends until school's out because Cherry start really early. So, I mean, it really depends on where you're at. And we're, of course, Mindy and I are on the east side in Yakima County. So what ends up happening is we usually start, all of us, but one school district starts in August. So that's not a big deal for us. Where on the west side, everybody starts after Labor Day. So that, that is going to be a bigger, shift for on the west side, definitely than the east side. But our schedule, with surveys, students told us basically it wasn't long enough. And that's exactly what the teacher said too. We did 9 to 12 in October. And it wasn't enough time, they said. So I've increased it another 30 minutes and was able to put in two lunches. We'll see how it goes in February. But the students were like, why not 1 o'clock, Mrs. Gredvig? But we'll see how it goes. But, it's kind of like a steady implementation for us for the first year.
That's awesome. We are coming to the end of our time. And I want to make sure to talk about resources before we go, but I hope that this information doesn't just stay in this room. I hope that it can spur some conversations with leaderships, with people in your department, and even with some students and families. So some resources to think about. And thank you for panel. We do have an unlocking federal and state program funds document. And if you're thinking about doing some braiding funding, looking at title dollars, that kind of thing, it's a good resource to check out. We have our engaged newsletter that we publish each month with related topics to our webinars. There's an awesome Padlet from both Union Gap and from Highland School District with documents in it, like their survey forms and things like their schedule on there to check out. So if you're thinking about looking at it, it'll help give you a boost to get started. We have a few pages listed here as well, and you can always connect with our staff if you have follow-up questions. We want to make sure you get them answered. David has an awesome Pinterest page with lots of stuff on there as well. And he shared with us some books to study. If you would like to do a book study or check it out, here's a few possible books, and you can get those in the slides. Please do subscribe to the newsletter and share it out with folks you think might be interested. We always have articles in there from awesome folks who are leaders in education, and it's geared towards a leadership team. Next month, we're going to be talking about mastery-based learning. We're going to have Joy Nolan with us, who is going to be talking about what this looks like and how you can start to think about it in your own community. And I am going to launch our evaluation poll. It is super helpful to us to get your feedback. We're starting to look at our next year's calendar. We do have kind of a longer form feedback survey. So if you'd like to go beyond the multiple choice buttons here and let us know what presenters you're interested in and what topics you'd like to learn about in this next year, that survey is going to be linked in our follow-up emails and things like that. So take advantage of that as well. And we'd love to see you get clock hours for joining us. If you join live, you've already registered for the year through Zoom. You'll also need to register for clock hours each month on PD Enroller. PD Enroller is going to send you an evaluation. It'll go to your email and we'll verify your attendance. And that's how we, and then we release those clock hours. If you watch the video later, the process changes a little bit. You register each month for clock hours in PD Enroller, and you complete the evaluation. And then you'll also do our graduation equity feedback survey. And that just signals to us that you watched the video. And then we verify your attendance every couple weeks. And that's how we release those clock hours. If you have questions about this, you can also email Ronnie Larson, who does our clock hours support. Thank you all so much for joining us, and we will see you next month.